Well, good morning, church family. Hope you had a great week this week. If you happen to be a first-time visitor here today, we do want to welcome you to Community Chapel of Heston. Please see a greeter or an usher before you leave. We have a special gift that we would like to give to you. Now, I don't know about you guys, but this week being able to watch a little bit of football Thursday and Saturday, that was a nice welcome, and just kind of getting you a little feeling like things are getting a little closer to normal, whatever normal really is. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed your week and maybe watching a little bit of football. I know this doesn't really affect you guys in the first service, but I just want to let you know we have made a change on our second service from 11 o'clock to 10:30. So I just want you guys to be aware that the second service in the morning is at 10:30, not 11 o'clock. The CE committee and children's team, they are making plans on starting children's church ministry. During the second service. That's going to begin in October sometime. They're still working on the details of what that's going to look like, but I just want to get that information out to you right now that we're looking to open up Children's Church. It'll be during the second morning service sometime in October. We do welcome you back tonight for our evening service here at the church at 6:30. And our youth groups, grades 6 to 12, at 6:15 at our church pavilion area. And again, on Wednesday, we have a Bible service in our gymnasium with Pastor Doug. We'd love to see you guys here at the gymnasium at 6:30 for our Bible study. Secret Sister Reveal Party is being planned for October 3rd. It'll be at the pavilion property, and it will be at 11 o'clock. So October 3rd, those who were involved in the Secret Sister Ministry program, you're going to have your reveal party at 11 o'clock on October 3rd at the pavilion. Sound booth. The gentlemen were just asking me here this morning if I could make an announcement. Anybody of any experience level, they're looking for some assistance. They really need to have about three people back there to get done what needs to be done. And you don't have to be an expert with computers or with sound system. They can train you. And if you're interested in that, please see Clint Maurer or Tim Upstead, and they will be excited about having you join them. Is that right, guys? All right. Nominating committee. Those who are involved in the nominating committee will have a meeting on Tuesday at 7 o'clock. I'm assuming it's going to be here in the conference room. All right, let's open our worship service now with prayer. Father, thank you so much for, again, another day that we can come into your house, worship you, praise you, glorify you, serve you, and just learn more about you, not just for head knowledge, but Lord, for our hearts to be changed and our hearts to be soft to see needs of others that need addressed, see needs in our own lives that need to be changed, and be able to walk a life that's honoring and glorifying to you. Father, I do want to take this opportunity to thank you for our tithes and offerings. As we haven't been passing the plate, Lord, I thank you for the church people here and their willingness to just continue to give their tithes and offerings. Lord, I do thank you for that. And Lord, I pray as it also is a form of worship to you. Lord, giving back to you what you have blessed us with. And Lord, I thank you for that. Father, I continue to pray for our school teachers and students. Just help them with a kind of change of learning style that just needs to be implemented at this time. And Lord, I pray for those teachers. It's, I'm sure, frustrating for them and for the students, frustrating as well. Lord, that you'll just help them to learn and get the material out there so they can just advance in their education. Lord, I pray for Pastor Scott as he brings forth a message to us. Lord, just anoint his lips. Help him to say those things that you would have him to say, and that he would just be, his mind will be clear and concise to express to us the words that you have given him through this week as he has studied for the sermon. Lord, help our hearts to be open and receptive as well. Lord, we do all this in your name, I pray. Amen. Some special music?
How great thou art, how great. of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
Okay, for our scripture reading today, it'll be in James chapter 2, verses 14 to 17. If you please stand for the reading of God's word. And again, it's James chapter 2, verses 14 to 17. What use is it, my brethren, if someone says he has faith, but he has no works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and one of you say to them, go in peace, be warm, be still, be filled, and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? Even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being by itself. You may be seated.
First in my heart. King of heaven, my treasure thou art.
High King of heaven, when victory is won, may I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Father, we come to you this morning. And if that could be the desire of each of our hearts as your children, that you and you alone would be our vision, our high tower, the one, whether waking or sleeping, we find that our confidence and our assurance rests in thee. Father, as we think about what was commemorated on Friday, we're reminded that 19 years ago that morning, this nation was rocked to its core. And Father, we talked often from September 11, 2001 throughout the years immediately following that about how quickly your people were brought to prayer. And I still remember the morning that that happened as the students at Lancaster Bible College were in chapel, and as we prayed corporately together, we were dismissed to go back to our dorms and to stay there, not knowing what was happening fully. And the school was on lockdown. But what blesses my heart is when I think back to those dorm sections, and each one had gone to prayer on behalf of this nation, had gone to prayer to seek your will, had gone to prayer to stand alongside of each other. And I remember a young lady named Christy, whose family member was in the one tower that collapsed, being able to minister to her and to the others who had family members in the Pentagon, and they didn't know at that moment if their father was even okay. It was a precious privilege for the household of faith to walk together, to pray together, to minister to one another, and to pull together in the time of storm. And so, Father, as we think of 9/11, as much as we remember the patriotism and the unity that this nation found restored, flags flying everywhere, we're remembered as the household of faith of our dire need to always be people of prayer, as well coming alongside of each other. And Lord, I pray that we also would remember as was shared in our morning prayer with the elders this morning, the ugly stain of sin and the impact and effects it has in lives. We saw that with countless thousands of families who've been impacted for the rest of their time here on this earth. And I pray, Lord, that we would also realize the need to stand against those things in our own hearts and lives. And so, Lord God, as we go into the Word this morning, as we continue through our series, the freedom we have through and in Christ, that you would be our vision today and every day from now until eternity. Give us the strength, Father, to stand in your Word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I saw countless times, whether social media or listening to folks this week, many of us knew exactly where we were that day, don't we? We remember every detail. Some of you had friends that were directly impacted, and as I shared with Christy and Sarah at Lancaster Bible College, were directly, immediately with family members. Some did not make it, and some did. But as we talked about, it really did bring to mind the absolute need, not just for the nation, but for the body of Christ to walk together in the Spirit of God. And that is exactly what we've been talking about the last several weeks. Last week especially, is we looked at, again, chapter 5, going into chapter 6, and what walking in the Spirit looks like practically, not some kind of theological discussion, not just some ideological belief that I say I believe this, but the genuine fruit of our lives, where the rubber meets the road kind of faith. And as we begin with our message today, burden bearers, you know, if we look at the scripture last week, it says, brethren, so we're talking to the church, if a man be overtaken in a fault, he finds himself or herself fallen into a season of sin or is overtaken by sin in their lives, you which are spiritual, not pious, not lofty, those who are grounded in their walks with Christ, spiritually mature, understanding the depth of their sin and brokenness, God's grace and mercy toward them is to then come alongside of those in that same spot. And it says, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. Remember, the meek person is the one who takes the blank check of their lives and submits it to the King of Glory and says, not my will, but yours be done, because they understand what God has done in their lives already. He says, with a spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. So he says, if someone has fallen into sin, restore them. But then we take the next step, verse 2, bear you, and this isn't on the screen just yet, but bear you one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. We're going to look at just a second what that looks like, but as we do, imagine a field, a large field, covered with a freshly fallen blanket of snow. And off to the one side of the field, you notice two figures entering from the corner. The first figure is a little larger than the second, so you're thinking perhaps it's a father and his son. As they walk across the field, you notice that the father is paying no particular attention necessarily where his feet fall. But you can't help but notice that the smaller second figure, likely the child, is taking every deliberate step they can to follow directly in his father's footsteps. After the two figures pass across the field into the woodline on the other side, you know that two people just walked across that field. But you only see one set of tracks from where you're standing. And I loved what the commentator went on to say. The Christian life, we talked about walking in the Spirit so we don't fulfill the desires of the flesh. Walking in the Spirit, letting the fruit of the Spirit shine in through our lives as Christ lived us through ours. He said the Christian life is that way. In our daily walk, we ought to be following Christ's example, walking in his steps. That makes sense with his life in us. And the question was asked, if someone were to observe the snow-covered fields of our lives, would there be one set of tracks, those of Christ, or two distinctive sets of tracks, one being his, the path we're to trod, and the other where we've meandered along the way? What a powerful question. And that led us right back, the illustration, to the difference we've been talking about, living in the power of the flesh, allowing the flesh to have sway in our hearts and our lives through the fruit of our lives, and the decisions that we make, things that we say, the things that we do, versus walking in step with God. Walking according to the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives, seeing that fruit develop from the inside out through God's eternal power. And you know, when you think about that, last week we saw the importance of being Nathans and the lives of those who had fallen. We saw the importance of being those who would come alongside of those who don't need pushed down but need a hand up, at least to help set their heart and their eyes, as long as they're willing, back on to Christ. And by God's gracious intervention through us, we have wonderful opportunities to come alongside the broken. If there's anything that maybe we've discovered through this season, and maybe even for some of us through the course of this week, it doesn't matter what's going on in the world around us. Those needs are still there. Broken people are still broken. They still need lifted. They still need mended. And they have burdens that need borne. And as we think about that in our text today, we see that God has called us as the household of faith to bear the burdens of one another. And as we talked about in Galatians 6, verse 2, as I get ready to read that verse, the main idea of the message today, you're going to hear it with the song that we close with the Brindle family, in just a little bit. But serving the God who bore our greatest burden, serving the God who bore our greatest burden, mine and yours, will move us to be willing to bear the burdens of others in our lives. The closer you get to Christ, the more frequently you will see your heart tender and softened to coming alongside of the broken in our lives. And so in Galatians 6:2, Paul says to the Galatian church, he just said, you know, walk in the Spirit. You won't fulfill the desires of the flesh. He says what walking in the flesh looks like versus the fruit of the Spirit. And then he goes in and says, bear you one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. And what I love is Paul saying, okay, you are so enamored with following the law, then let me give you a law to follow. He says, so follow, fulfill the law of Christ. In John 13, 34, Jesus said these words, a new commandment I give unto you. So I know what these Pharisees and scribes and religious leaders have been teaching you, but this is what I'm here to tell you. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. And genuinely, you could walk out of this sanctuary today and just spend several hours focused upon the fact that Christ has loved you in an amazing way. I think there's a reason the psalmist in Psalm 1 says, upon this law he meditates day and night. To constantly be reminded of the goodness, of the grace, the love and the mercy of his God. In John 15, 12 to 14, Jesus said, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. What does that love look like? Verse 13, greater love has no man than this. Jesus said, if you want to see the greatest expression of the love that he's talking about, is that a man lay down his life for his friends. He says, you are my friends if you do whatsoever I command. And in 1 John 4, 11 to 12, knowing what Jesus just said, what he's called them to, he then says, John shares that, beloved, if God so loved us how much that Jesus died in our place on a cross that we should have been bearing our own sins, but he bore it in our place. If God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man has seen God at any time. That is a powerful statement. No man has seen God the Father at any time. And that still holds true. But listen to what the Word of God says. If we love one another, God dwells in us and his love is perfected in us. So God is calling the body and bride of Christ to make him known through his life in and through ours. And so what does that look like? Very practical way. Not just do we lift the sinner caught in sin, but then Paul says bear one another. Bear means to take up, to carry. It means to remove. And you'll see in just a minute, it's to take up, to carry, to remove a burden that's literally crushing the person in front of you. Like they are genuinely being crushed. This isn't just an inconvenience. This isn't something that they maybe just got into themselves because of a little bit of neglect. This is a genuine need or a brokenness, a tragedy, an emergency, a spiritual brokenness that's come along that has rendered them crushed. And he says, so bear one another's burden. That's that weight that's too much for them to carry. And as we think about those words that Paul shared, he gives direction as to how we should go about burden bearing. And I'm just going to throw this out before we even get started. Doing what God calls us to do in this scripture will call you to look past the end of your own nose. And mine as well. To respond to the call that God has placed upon his children will call you to resist the flesh. And for us to look past the end of ourselves. Listen, to genuinely see this broken and hurting. I will never forget the calloused words And I say that because I was angry too about what the Al-Qaeda terrorists did. But as men and women of God, as those hateful words, and I can tell you as a 21-year-old man, 22 at that point, I just turned 22, some mean things left my mouth, and God convicted us through a speaker that reminded us that there was a time when we stood in a debt load of sin that we couldn't pay or get out from under, and but God, that we should have been praying for those terrorists. But to do that, we'd have to get past ourselves. Well, as we think about all of those things, the first thing that we'll see in this text, Paul's command presupposes that burdens will come. We're going through a wonderful series on Sunday evening. And I want to encourage you, we're excited to get things rolling again with Sunday evening, Wednesday night, youth group. You heard in the announcements, children's church, the leadership is working very hard. And I'm grateful for the steps they're taking to get back to not normal where it used to be. And I say that because sometimes the old normal, not all of old normal was good. But getting back to where we can minister, serve, come alongside of each other. And so those services are available. And that one on Sunday night has really challenged because there are teachers out there that will tell you, and many are very popular, sell lots of books, make lots of money at your expense. Because they tell you what you want to hear, that if you just do enough, have enough faith, burdens won't come. That's a lie from the pit of Hades. Paul just said right here, he says, bear you one another's burdens. Why do we have to do that? Because Paul is already presupposing that burdens, heavy weights, and trials will come. We are not exempt in the body of Christ from the burdens that we will face. Whether it's your things just blowing apart. We see house fires. Does that mean you had a lack of faith? No, you may have had faulty wiring. Trials and tribulations will come. It does not mean that you've not done the right things. But in those trials, we have an opportunity to do the right things. In John 16:33, Jesus himself said, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. Why in the world do we need peace? Because Jesus knows we're going to be in the midst of storms, and in him we're going to need that peace. In the world you shall have what? What if you pay enough? What if you... Jesus says, you shall have tribulation, but listen, take heart, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. In James 1, verses 2 to 4, James says, consider it all joy, my brethren, when you have encountered various trials. Does this mean, James, like you should be like, woohoo? You know, just walked into the biggest storm of my life. Should I be super excited about that? It's not necessarily the trial that you are excited about. But listen to what he says in verse 3, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. I heard a pastor say about 9 years ago, a faith that can't be tested is a faith that can't be trusted. And we should thank God for the storms that come along, for the testing and the trying of our faith, that we grow some spiritual muscles and sharpen those spiritual teeth. And James says, and let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. So burdens will come. You can talk to the missionaries who are behind bars right now. Or to the families of those missionaries and Christians who have lost their lives by sharing the gospel. Persecution will come. Financial crises will come. Deep, deep and dark valleys will come in and through our lives. But as they come, as the body of Christ, we are challenged to remember that those brothers and sisters are not to suffer them and bear them alone. We're not to bear them alone. And so Paul's command indicates that each of us are to do our part. So bear you one another's burdens. So in other words, as we look to fulfill the law of Christ in Galatians 6:2, bear you one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. In other words, in response to God's love toward us. So that's the love that God has demonstrated through Christ on the cross that's then manifested in and through our lives by our response to the people in our lives. He says, you're not to let your brothers and sisters get crushed under the weight of their burdens. Well, the next question may come is this, but what if I have struggles of my own? what if I have my own struggles right now? And the truth is, we do. We all do. At different times, we all will have struggles and trials and adversities that we're going through. There are going to be setbacks that we're going to have to face. But can I tell you that with full confidence, in the midst of that, you can still minister to others? In fact, I would be so bold to say, and you're going to see this in just a moment through God's word, it'll do the talking. Some of the greatest encouragement, I've heard that a lot, about our need for encouragement. What I know is I like to be encouraged. That's why these popular preachers today are good, because they encourage you. They tell you how good you are. You're a good boy. Just keep giving, and things will just keep coming. But I also heard a pastor share this past week, as much as we like to be encouraged, some of the greatest encouragement we get is when we are an encouragement. Did you hear that? You want encouragement in your heart and life, be an encouragement to someone else. Do you think Paul is onto something here in Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, of the need of the body of Christ to bear one another's burdens? But what if I have my own struggles? Let's listen to the church in Philippi. Philippians 2, verses 3 through 4, Paul says, "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves." Is that to totally desecrate and denigrate yourself? No. It's not to devalue yourself. But in seeing past ourselves, we see the brokenness, the needs, the hurts, the wants, and the struggles of others in light of that. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Well, what does that look like? In a very practical way, Philippians 4, 15 through 16, Paul said this to the church in Philippi at the end of his letter. "You yourselves," and I just want you to know this is not in reference to giving. I know we're talking about giving. Don't take it that way. Listen to the heart of the Philippians as they go above and beyond. He said, "You yourselves also know, Philippians, that at the first preaching of the gospel, after I left Macedonia, no church," how many? None. No church that had received the same gospel that they had, whose lives had been impacted in the same way that they had. "No church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, but you alone. For even in Thessalonica, you sent a gift more than once for my needs." It had not been that long removed from when he left Philippi to get to Thessalonica, and he said, "And while I was there, you gave more than once." You're like, well, that's a nice story. That's really cool that they were willing to do that. But when we go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, you realize the significance of what this Philippian church really did. As Paul was finishing up the third missionary journey, he's gathering this offering to take back with him to Jerusalem. The Jerusalem church is impoverished. They are financially in ruins. They are struggling. They are hurting really bad. And so he's gathering this offering to take back to them, but it's twofold, not just to meet their needs. He wants them to understand that God is doing a great work throughout the entire Gentile world, not just in Jerusalem, but he wants them to see that there's this unified church from the Gentile churches and nations as well. And so he has a purpose. And as he challenges the Corinthian church, who is in a position to really give, they're in a position to give, and kind of imploring them to open up their hearts, he uses the example of the Philippian church and the Macedonians. And in 2 Corinthians 8, verse 1, "Now, brethren, we wish to make known to you the grace of God which has been given in the churches of Macedonia. Then at a great ordeal of affliction, their abundance of joy and their deep poverty overflowed in the wealth of their liberality. For I testify that according to their ability," so you listen to how they gave, according to their ability, that's what they could give. Then he goes on to say, "And beyond their ability," now they're pinching, "now they have given sacrificially to where their own needs or wants are getting set aside so that they can give to someone else." And listen to how they gave. "They gave of their own accord, begging us with much urging for the favor of participation in the support of the saints." They literally begged Paul to allow them to give this way to the Jerusalem church. And what's really cool is Paul did not expect that to come. Not as we expected, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and to us by the will of God. Paul's like, listen, I was just wanting them to surrender their lives to Christ. Like, that was our goal for the Philippians as the church was planted, as we ministered. But in submitting themselves to Christ, they saw a burden that need borne in Jerusalem. And they're like, listen, we're broken. and we're impoverished, but they're in worse shape than we are, please take this gift and give it to the Jerusalem church. In the midst of their own need. Now, this isn't just about finances. I know that's an example. But whatever we're going through individually right now, do you know that there is someone alongside of you that still needs a touch of God's grace? I want to challenge each of us this morning, because as you come alongside of someone who's in need and you meet that need, you also find that not only will God encourage the person you just helped bear their burden, but you'll find yours lightened a bit as well. But what if I don't want to ask for help, Pastor Scott? The other week we asked you to lift your hands if you had a prayer request. You had a burden that you were bearing. And a lot of people raised their hands, didn't they? But I wonder how many of us were willing to share with someone before that moment what that burden really was. How many of us are willing to tap out, cry uncle, look for the assistance of our brother and sister before we were completely flattened and crushed? Each and every one of us, there is not a rogue Christian. It's not meant to be that way. The word ecclesia in the Greek means the called out ones. We've been called out together. We have the local body and we have the universal church. But we've been called to do life together. We've not been called to do this alone. Not to lift one burden alone. A young boy was doing his best to lift a rock that was too large for someone his size. He grunted and he puffed as he tried various methods for lifting and rolling this rock, but in spite of all his efforts, the rock wouldn't budge. His father walked by and, watching his son struggle, asked, obviously, "Are you having trouble, son?" And he said, "Yeah." He said, "I've tried absolutely everything, and Dad, it won't move." The father replied, "Are you sure that you have tried absolutely everything? That you've used every resource at your disposal?" The boy looked up with frustration, exasperation, and exhaustion. He's like, "Yes!" He's sweating. He's dirty. He's tired. He's sore. And his dad, with kindness and tenderness, bent over and softly said, "No, my son, you have not. You have not asked me." And how often, the commentator went on to say, that we're like the little boy struggling with our problems but unable to solve them by ourselves. And he said it's because we've not asked for our Heavenly Father's help. And I've actually heard it said that, you know, I need to go to God. And I agree with that. That is who we turn to first. 1 Peter 5:6-7 says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God." Peter is writing this to the scattered church. They're scattered throughout all Asia Minor. Rome has ramped up its persecution. Unbelievers with spouses or with sons or with brothers who had come to Christ had cast them out onto their own. And so these people are hurting. And in the midst of the press, Peter says, "Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you." We absolutely, in the midst of the darkest, deepest times, we are absolutely to submit ourselves to the loving care of God, trusting in him and what he's doing through them. In Psalm 55:22, the word of God says, "Cast your burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain you." And that is absolutely true. We go first and foremost as the child of God to our Father God. But what's really, really special, it's the theme of the t-shirts that our children and our youth wear and our adult helpers throughout each missions week, that we are his hands and feet. What you will find when you pray for needs in your heart and life that need genuinely met, God does not, like, it's not like he can't move and he himself isn't meeting them. What you will find is he will move the hands and feet of his people to meet that need, to bear that load. And that's what we have been called to do. And you know what? As we think about that, we need to be willing to tap out and ask for help. We need to be willing to give help. And that leads us to point number three in the next verse in Paul's instruction. We're going to see that Paul's command not only presupposes that trials will come, not only presupposes that each of us have a part to do, but Paul's command indicates there's no place for pride in burden bearing. Not in the place of the recipient, but also in the place of the giver. And why would we say that? Because Paul says in verse 3, for if a man thinks himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. Remember what Paul said in Romans 12:3, that we shouldn't think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Muhammad Ali, it's alleged one time, had boarded an airplane. And getting ready to depart, the stewardess said, Mr. Ali, you need to fasten your seatbelt. And smugly, Muhammad Ali, in his pride, said, Superman don't need no seatbelt. Quick-witted, the flight attendant said, that's great because Superman don't need no plane, so I suggest you buckle up. In his pride, he didn't want to receive the help that was given him. But as we keep reading in verse 4, but let every man prove his own work, and this may seem contradictory. We're not to be prideful, but let every man prove his own work, and then he shall have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. What in the world does Paul mean? Do you remember the Pharisee's prayer in Luke chapter 18 and verses 9 through 14? Remember when the Pharisee and the tax collector came up to the temple to pray? Let me just paraphrase. God, I thank you that I'm not like him. I'm better than him. I'm your gift to yourself. You're welcome. Remember what he said? I'm glad I'm not like him, and I do this, and I do that. Look at how super awesome I am. All the while, did you hear what he said? I'm glad I'm not like him, and I don't do what he does. He compared himself against a man instead of the bar being Christ and his righteousness. And what he was trying to do was just look a little better than the people around him. And in so doing, he thought that would make him look good before other men, and foolishly, that would look good before God. And we know that God is not a respecter of persons in that way. What you can also take from what he said is that there's not a chance that this man would ever intend to lighten the load of the tax collector that he's maligning, unless it benefited him some way. That's the challenge in reference. We look at this verse and no place for pride. Because the challenge is, and we probably all can to a degree struggle with that. When we see a need, do we meet the need? Do we lift the burden? Do we lighten the load? Because that's what God has absolutely called us to and for the benefit of the other. Or do we do it because it might make us look better? And so Paul addresses that. He addresses the need to be willing to even ask for help, but also in how we give help. And in reference to that, in Matthew 23, verses 1 through 4, and Paul, having been a Pharisee himself, would have understood exactly what Jesus meant in Matthew 23. Then Jesus spoke to the crowds and his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees have seated themselves. Last week, we ended with a precious scripture where Paul identified himself as the chief of sinners. Reminded us that Jesus came not to be our heavenly sugar daddy, but to save sinners, of whom I am chief. But even before that, remember we said about how remarkably in awe Paul was that God would even choose to use a wretched sinner like him to proclaim the beautiful treasure of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Remember what he said, because he has enabled me, having called me, putting me into the ministry. Paul was so quick to give God the glory for everything in his life. And yet we see the scribes and the Pharisees have seated themselves in the chair of Moses. He says, so therefore, all that they tell you, do and observe. He said, listen, what they're saying is right. But but do not do according to their deeds, for they say things and do not do them. Do you know people in your life who are good at telling you what you should do, but not very adept at doing it themselves? More important question, do we ask ourselves, am I the person that's good at telling people what to do? I'm not very good at doing it myself. Jesus really comes down hard on that kind of prideful thinking. He says, they tie up heavy burdens and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves are unwilling to move them with so much as a finger. They'll put weight on the shoulders of the people around them, but won't lift a finger to move them themselves. Because the problem is, it's easier to base your standing on those around you than it is to actually honoring and following God's word, isn't it? And Jesus says that's dangerous and wrong. And that's where we see the meaning of verse 4. Listen to verse 4. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. As you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 12, listen to what Paul says. And he was constantly having to defend the genuine nature of his ministry, constantly combating those of the Pharisees and the Judaizers who were steeped in law. And you'll see the battle that he had to face. For we are not bold to class or compare ourselves with some of those who commend themselves. But when they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they're without understanding. Literally, we're going around living lives just looking at each other. And as long as we're doing just a little bit better, or at least the same as the person beside us, then we're okay. But 2 Corinthians 10:18 says, for it is not he who commends himself that is approved, but he whom the Lord commends. And that is the meaning of verse 4. That is what Paul is trying to implore his readers to grab a hold of. When we leave this room, or maybe you don't even have to leave this room today, and you have an opportunity to really come alongside of a brother and sister in Christ, or you know what, or even an unbeliever, an opportunity to be Christ's hands and feet, his mouthpiece to them. We need to be very conscious that we're measuring our words and works of love, not against each other, but against the law of Christ. As you leave this room today, knowing what Christ has done in your stead, knowing the people that he's placed in your life along the way. And you know, I want to encourage you in your quiet time, and take quiet time today to really think about that. Whether you've been saved for 2 years or 70 years, God has placed people along the way to encourage you, to lift you, to correct you. You might think to frustrate you, but really it's for your good, hopefully, to keep pointing you to Christ, to lighten the burdens and the loads that you couldn't lift on your own. But in so doing, we get to verse 5 and you're like, isn't this out of place? For every man shall bear his own burden. Well, you just spent the last 30 minutes telling us that we should be bearing each other's burdens. We all have a part to play. We should be willing to let people bear our burdens. And there shouldn't be pride in doing it, but now you're saying we should bear our own burdens. Isn't that like circle? No, it's not. Because that's where studying the Word of God and knowing the Word of God comes in. I want to encourage you, if you do not have a Strong's Exhaustive Concordance, get one. If you have a computer and you can get a Greek or Hebrew word tool, get one. Because what's really cool when you look up these two words, burdens, they might look the same in the English language, but they're not the same in the Greek. And it makes perfect sense. What Paul says is we're to bear one another's burdens. So when there is a crushing load on a brother and sister, they didn't see it coming. They didn't expect it. You know, it may be the family that just lost that loved one. It may be the wife whose husband just left. It may be the family that just lost that child. It may be the job that was cut and was eliminated. It may be the house that burnt to the ground. But a burden has befallen that family, that couple, that person, and they can't bear it alone. And that's the word in verse 2, baros, a heavy weight or burden, too heavy to carry alone. But it's almost important to that Paul would say this, because what happens when people see people start carrying burdens, I don't want to say we can get lazy, but we could presume upon the grace of God's people, couldn't we? And so when he says, let every man bear his own burden, that's the word phorteon in the Greek. And that fleshed out means equivalent to the weight of a man's pack. What does that look like? You're standing at the end of the bus stop on the first day of school. You have the mail in your left hand. Importantly, you have your Yeti coffee mug in your other hand. You've got the dog's leash wrapped around your left wrist. So you've got a dog, the mail, and your coffee. None of those can be dropped, especially the coffee. And your child gets off the bus, whips off the backpack, says, here, you carry this. I don't think so. You carry that yourself. That's your backpack. You carry it up the lane, or take all of these. That's what Paul's talking about. It's the weight meant for each of us as individuals to bear. And listen, in grace, sometimes as much as we need to be quick to realize what's our own weight to bear, you may have to also be gracious in the life of the people you encounter, that you let them know that's their weight to bear graciously as well. And so in other words, don't step in and take over the responsibility someone else was meant to carry. But let us not walk out of here blinded to the needs of others either. And if there's somewhere you can step in and help, and I'll be quick to say, if that need has been laid on your plate, remember Matthew 9. Jesus asked his disciples to pray that God would send laborers into the field. In Matthew chapter 10, Jesus sent them. Realize when you see the needs of others, you may be the very answer to your own and their prayer. And so let us, in God's grace, be willing to bear those burdens. Father, as we come before the throne of grace today, we thank you for the opportunity to be here together. Father, we thank you for the many gifts you have bestowed upon us as your children, the gift of salvation. Lord, as we think about bearing burdens, Lord, we don't have to go any further than the cross when we think of the greatest burden you bore for us. We're getting ready to hear about that in just a moment. But the Bible says that when we were yet without strength, we were being crushed spiritually under a weight that we could never bear alone. There was no chance that we could lift it off of ourselves. When we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Lord, when we weren't even seeking you, you died in our place, bearing our sin, so that, Lord, in crying out to you, that burden could be lifted. And we were reminded in the book of John and in 1 John that knowing the love of God extended to us in that way, we have been called as your people to love one another. And we saw practically the last 2 weeks what that looks like in the first verse. Coming alongside of that brother or sister stuck in sin, not to shame them, not to rub it in their face. But Lord, in accordance to the grace and mercy you've lavished upon us, to see them restored. And Father, when that brother or sister is burdened and being crushed under a weight they can't lift on their own, in the same way, just as you bore our greatest burden, you are calling us as the household of faith to bear those burdens together. Father, we know they'll come. We know that each of us are called to do our part. We know that there is no place for pride. And Lord, as we leave this place, we need your help. Number one, to be willing to ask for help. If we're broken right here this morning, to be willing to come and ask a brother or sister in Christ if they could pray for us. And Lord, in so doing, we may just be revealing the need for help that they can come alongside of us. But Lord, also when that person comes to us, that we're willing to render assistance. And not for our glory, but yours. But also give us the wisdom as we leave here today to know the difference between what we're supposed to bear with them and as a Christian, what you've called us to bear alone. And Lord, we ask for your help to do all those things well. Thank you for meeting our greatest need. And as these young ladies sing for us today, might we be encouraged with the greater gift. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Grace and Faith. Let's pray. Father, open our eyes to see and do our parts to help those who are in need around us. Lord, help us this week as we go through our daily routines, that we just see the burdens of others that need to be shared. And Lord, thank you for the word that you gave Pastor Scott to preach to us today. And Lord, that was meant for us. And Lord, help us to apply what we heard today in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.